Good afternoon to everyone. So glad that you are here. And I want to say thank you to Shaw and to Young and to Turnbow and to Sonora for being here in the room with us today. It sure does make teaching to a live audience a lot easier for us. And now for all of those of you who are out there in the schools, we are so glad you're joining us. This is a pretty exciting day. I don't know of any other school district in the entire state of Arkansas who even attempts to do professional development like this. So I thank you. I know that you've already done a lot of professional development through your schools, and you've been working hard, and I'm getting all kinds of emails. Can I start now? Can I start now? So the answer is, as soon as testing ends, work with your schools, and you can determine when you will begin to teach those first units. So I'm really, really excited that we are now getting to talk directly to teachers. We've been delivering through your leadership teams, and I know they've done a wonderful job, but now we get to actually talk directly to teachers. So I'm really excited about that, too. We've got a great afternoon planned for you. We have the world's best trainer to deliver that message. And so here she is, Charlene Horner.
I just feel like I probably should introduce myself and give a little bit of background about what I do in this district currently, and then also tell you something that I don't know really a whole lot about. I am Charlene Horner, and I'm an instructional facilitator at Sonora Middle School. I have worked with workshop teaching in some form or capacity for over 16 years. I have worked with schools to implement and refine their practice of this either reading or writing workshop, and I have been trained by the Teachers College of Reading Writing Institute. I gave you that info because I'm letting you know that while I know a little bit about workshop teaching, I don't know much. I'm not an expert at delivering PD live stream. So please be patient with me. I'm learning at the morning group. It worked pretty well, and there's some feedback that will work through the little tweaks. So this is new for me, and so if you see my little hands shaking, please excuse and just be nice to me, I guess. That's all I'm asking. That was my purpose in saying that. All right, so we have some materials that you probably already knew that we would need to be successful today. You would need these items, and most of our tables already have these, or you've brought these tools with you. The way this day is set up is actually demonstration teaching. So this is the type of teaching that you'll be doing within your own rooms very shortly. A lot of, like, I'm going to show you how to do this, and then you actually get to try this work. So again, I'm going to model some things today, and then you're going to actually get to try some of this work. And to be able to do that, you'll need these tools to be a learner today. And Rick DeFore, a lot of times from the Solution Tree, he would so eloquently say, there is learning by doing something, and that is exactly what we're doing today. I will not tell you a bunch of stuff and then say, I hope you can do this at your buildings. We're actually I'm going to tell you some things that you could do. We're going to try these things and work them out today. And then we certainly are going to refine that practice over the course of the next year or maybe even just the next few weeks in our buildings. So we're going to learn by doing today. Okay. That was my point in that. And then I have our goals today. And I think this is important too. Just good teachers let kids know and understand the goals for a particular lesson or goals for the day or goals for the year. When planning for this day, we knew that we definitely wanted to give you some instruction on how to get ready to actually teach this unit in May. Just give a shot at it. We're just kind of just trying this thing in May, and I wanted to give you some tools to feel like you're not just thrown in, and I want to maybe kind of show you some or tell you some things that we made mistakes on and tell you how we've refined that practice just by doing, and also getting feedback from the Teachers College along the way of, you know, you could have done it this way, you might have done it this way. So I'm sharing some of what we have, our troubles along the way. I don't think it's really troubles. That's learning, is trying things. So today I want you to be able to leave here with an understanding of how you can collaborate with your PLC to prepare yourself to teach a new unit, and then also to prepare yourself to actually teach just one, you know, like how do you plan for next week of instruction? And that's what we will also delve into today, too. Then we want you to also leave with some tools that help support whole school systems, that support engagement and independence. So those are our goals today. And reflecting on the morning, I feel like everyone left achieving those goals. And I hope that you will, too. If we do this, I think you'll feel good. You'll feel like this is going to be new type of work that we have not done before, and maybe think about how we can really do this collaboratively to be efficient with our work and for the best interest of our kids. Okay, so how we've set this up is if you have questions, and this is for you in this room or out in the district. If you have questions along the way, schools might have a chat monitor, and this person could type in the questions, and then we have Megan Rojo, who is kind of monitoring that site for us and letting me know of those questions. So how I typically run with PD and questions, I will definitely work to tuck those answers. I will be responsive to your questions and tuck those answers into my lessons. If they don't naturally fit into my lessons, then I will explicitly address those questions in isolation at the end. And if we don't have time at the end to explicitly address those questions at the end, I will definitely send you an email. I'm pretty good that way. Like I follow through, and I want to make sure that your questions are answered. So please post your questions along the way. I will work to be responsive to those. I anticipate lots of questions. Please know that's a part of this process. I would be actually worried if there weren't any questions. I would be concerned a little bit if there weren't. I anticipate questions not just today, but along this way, and because we're all learners in this together. So that's how we kind of roll with the questions. And then this is some feedback we got from the morning. We felt like we probably need to let you have a little bit of time to join this Google Classroom. To give you a little background on this, this classroom was established right after Christmas when your principals and IFs and assistant principals joined us to actually learn about the reading units of study. And so along the way, we post pictures and new documents that are coming. This is just kind of so we don't have all the emails, separate emails in isolation. We just kind of keep this all in one place. So I encourage you to join this. When you join this Google Classroom, you will find this Google slide presentation. Thank you. The Google slide presentation for grade 3. And you're welcome to follow along in that if you want to. So, and you'll need that for sure at the end to be able to follow along. So point being, please join the Google Classroom. And then I'll give you about a minute to do that. And then we're actually going to get started. Sound all right? All right. Thanks. And to clarify, for the friends in this room, you certainly don't have to follow along slide by slide. This today is not a sit and get, follow along on the Google slide, but it is meant for you to be, it's a resource for you to tap into frequently. I assume that you'll probably, as a PLC, look to this as a resource for you. Maybe every day or once a week or so, but it's meant to be a resource. To give you a little background on where we are and the baseline of where we are as a district. So I'm assuming, and I fully understand, I am assuming that most or all of our elementary schools have had some time to research and learn about what good readers need, and you've probably spent some time learning about the structure of a reading workshop, you know, how this follows. Probably as a building, you have talked about how this fits into the balanced literacy model and how this fits for your grade level and how this fits within your building. I am assuming that you all have maybe had a little bit of time to look inside your kits and see what's inside your kits and maybe even been introduced to some of the resources and tools that are within that kit. To be ready for today, I just needed us to have that baseline. Like we were all as a district, we might be in little different spots here or there, but for the most part, that we don't, we have a pretty good understanding of this today, and we have a pretty good understanding and know how important that long blocks of time are for kids to read. So we were able to actually learn today how to do two things. One is we're going to learn how to unpack a new unit of study, and the second one is how to plan. Let me back up. I want to use the word we. How do we, as a PLC, unpack a new unit of study, and how do we, as a PLC, plan for next week of instruction? I like to use that word we because this is definitely not, this work is not for the weak at heart. This does require collaborative cultures and communities to work together. So I think it's important to use that word we. What's going to happen is I'm going to pull a group to the carpet, and please know I'm not, no disrespect, I'm just used to saying I'm pulling the kids to the carpet, and I know you're an adult, but if I do happen to say kids, please know. I'm going to pull a group to the carpet, and you're going to actually, out here, you're going to kind of look into this classroom. But you're going to be doing the same work out here. You'll be doing the same work that they're doing, but you'll have the opportunity to look into this classroom. I feel like that's important work. Again, that's demonstration teaching happening. So I'm going to invite, I think I might invite Turnbow and Sonora to come to the carpet. And what you'll need are three tools. You'll need your Unit 1, Grade 3, Unit of Study. You'll also need some type of writing tool. You know, it could be a pencil or a pen or a crayon, just something that you, or a highlighter, something that you are, you know, use when you read nonfiction text to help you. And you'll also probably need a piece of paper. Some people bring post-it notes, some people bring a pad of paper, just, you know, whatever works for you. But three tools, one a unit, the unit that we're about ready to teach. The second is a writing tool, and the third is a piece of paper. And the rest of us are going to look in and see how fast and fluid they come to the carpet and be ready for instruction. All right. So readers, I'm so glad you're here today. Y'all came to the carpet so fast and fluent. My connection for you today is that I know that you have been hearing the words reading units of study, and I know you have been maybe spent some time looking at this particular book. But I am going to tell you a little short story about us as a PLC at my school. I need to get my other lesson plan. Hold on. Does that ever happen in your classrooms that you say, oh, I have the wrong? Okay. I want to tell you this little story. It starts with our PLC probably about 2 years ago when we implemented the writing. We got the units and we unpacked them, or we unwrapped them, you know, that plastic wrap, and you can hear it and it crinkles and you're excited and everything's brand new. As the instructional facilitator, I couldn't wait to teach Unit 1. My teachers couldn't wait to teach Unit 1. We were just so excited to do this work. And I just said, okay, just, you know, let's just dive in. Let's just teach Unit 1 and not have any understanding of what we're going to teach other than just the title. And that didn't work out so well. Let me just explain to you that we started to teach Lesson 1 and we had no idea what Lesson 2 was going to be and no idea what Lesson 3 was going to be. And we quickly, the feedback came real quick that this was not quite working. Our kids are confused. I'm confused. And quite honestly, their instruction facilitator was confused. So we kind of took a step back and said, let me just kind of tell you something. I think, you know, Lucy often references the orientation to the unit. She says this a lot and really says it with very clear instructions on how to read it. We're going to try that. So we did, and that was a game changer for our PLC. We kind of had we constructed an overview of what this unit was going to be other than just the title. And this really helped us just understand what we were going to be asking our kids to do right then and there or along the way. So today I want us to learn how you can do this as a PLC that's manageable. If you've watched the orientation to the units of study, you might have seen how Lucy references how to do this work. And certainly it follows pretty in sync with what she has done. Us as a PLC, we've worked to tweak it a little bit. But basically what this looks like is you assign parts to read of the orientation to the unit to each member of the PLC. Each member reads that for about 7 minutes. And this timing is being responsive to our PLC, like being within the time constraint. This is not any researcher saying that you should be reading for 4 minutes. It's just like the time allowed that we have, what can we do within that time? Each PLC member then reports back what they learned about the orientation. And then there's time for this whole class conversation where, like, what you said can build on to what you have said and what you have learned. And this way you're able to clarify and construct a coherent overview of the unit. Big picture is if you're not clear of this unit, your kids won't be clear. And that's just being honest. And so this protocol is something that we follow as a PLC. We tend to put this one on our in-service days or maybe a staff meeting day. And it's really been nice the past 2 years. Those in-service days have fallen on good breaks where we might have a break where or an in-service day where we could reflect on the past unit and then do this work to get to know our new unit. Then another in-service day fit really nicely that we could reflect on the past unit and then do this work to get ourselves ready for the next unit. That's when we've chosen to insert this type of work. In your own building, you can figure out those systems. But more importantly, I want you to know that I would probably suggest this is where to start before you start just teaching, you know, teaching lesson one. Okay, so we're going to give a little shot at this work. This is just kind of giving us a little bit of taste of how this feels, and how this feels to read pretty fast and skimming pretty fast and being able to share with friends and learn with friends. So how this is going to work right now, just us on the carpet and us that are listening in. I'm going to give us 2 minutes to read. Bless you. The orientation to the unit is this page right here. And all the while, you know, you're reading this because you're going to teach a friend something about this unit. So you read with a purpose. It's nice to always tell your kids what they're reading for. And the purpose is you're going to get to be a teacher of what understanding you get from this overview. So we'll read for two, and then and I'll set my timer in and make sure that you know when 1 minute's up, and then we'll share with our partners, okay? All right, so you may begin reading the overview or orientation to the unit. About 1 more minute. And we'll stop there. That was pretty fast-paced. You just kind of got a gist of what this, how this unit might over might unfold. I'm now going to ask that you just kind of maybe turn to a partner. I don't have those structures and routines set up in this room, so I'm just going to say those words: turn to a partner, and talk about maybe a new understanding you have, or something that you know that will that your kids, what type of instruction they're going to get, or what type of books they're going to be reading in this unit. It might start out like, I'm trying to think. I didn't realize that this unit is going to entail some of the routines and structures that that need to be in place for this teaching to actually occur. And then how would you say that back to, or would you add on to what I'm saying, or would you start a new topic? How could you do that? How can we push ourselves to think or talk long about a subject?
I would say, I agree with you, I saw that too. I also noticed that the tells us the big work of the unit, and that you were laying the groundwork for the whole rest of the year.
Nice. So I encourage you to push yourself to kind of add on to what your partner might have said. Or if it just isn't, it doesn't work to add on, then maybe start with a new understanding you have. So for about 2 minutes, turn to your partner and talk about what you are learning in this orientation.
Like the definitely
All right. So that was just a little taste of what we're about ready to do. What we did was we read a little bit, and then we got to talk with our partners, and teaching kids how to talk in response to text is something that we not only have to teach, but provide time for them to do that on a regular basis. So some of the things that I was hearing were, I didn't realize the routines and structures. You had talked about lifelong readers and reflecting on some of the kids that we have in our rooms currently right now. I don't know that they are. They feel like they're lifelong readers at this point. So just kind of internalizing, like reading Lucy's words, but then also how does that work in my room, or how does that work for me to give that instruction or change these readers' thinking or my own thinking. The purpose here, though, is for you to just kind of get construct an overview of how this unit is going to unfold. And there's every unit follows the same pattern. It starts with the orientation of the unit. She talks about the assessments that will be in place. She talks about how bend 1, 2, and 3 fall unfold throughout every unit. Everything is meant to be simple and predictable. There's my timer. I'm trying to stay true to my 10-minute instruction. I'm working on that. I'm going to take one more minute. Where I was going with that is I don't remember. Okay, so we are going to release to actually try this work as a PLC, and how this is going to look. I wrote this is within the thought that you have 4 people on your team. I realize that some people have 5, and some people have 6, and maybe people have 3. Just make it work for your team. But we're going to have one person skimming the learning progressions, one person skimming the bend 1, one person doing each of these, and then each person will skim the assessment section in 7 minutes. So this is quick, this is fast-paced, just kind of reading to get the gist. Many people I've noticed were jotting off to the side, some were highlighting, some were writing on post-it notes, whatever seems to work for you at this moment in your learning journey of nonfiction reading. And then after the 7 minutes, we will have time to teach each other about what you learned in that particular section. So we're going to, people out that are listening in, you could definitely turn your sound down for about 7 minutes, and then that way you can still see us and see what we're doing and know when we're starting back, and y'all would still be able to read and think without some distractions. So when we release and I say those magic words, off you go, you are going to go back to your seats, determine within your PLC who's going to read which section, and then begin reading, okay? And I'll let you know when we have about 1 more minute left, okay? All right, off you go.
So I'm going to do some.
more minutes. Thirty more seconds for you to finish that thought or section. All right, so writers and readers, we have had a little block of time to actually read, and I understand this is very fast-paced and this will get easier. The language across the units, her phrases are duplicated across the units, so you'll be able to read these faster with more experience with these units. But for the most part, if you can just kind of get a gist and know that you're going to teach your friends and be able to be learners together in this, then we've achieved our goal. So we are now going to kind of practice the 4 minutes to kind of share what you learned in your little chunk of your reading and how this unit is going to unfold, or maybe what the teaching is going to be to your kids. So it'll kind of look like this. You'll teach for 4 minutes and you'll just be talking to your friends, and we'll try not to have the clarifying conversations there. We'll try not to, but we'll go ahead and you'll teach your section and you'll teach your section and you'll teach your section. And then I'll stay true to providing that time for whole class. Oh, where is it? This part right here. This is the part where I want to make sure that I don't work past this, because this is the part where we've heard all the information. This is the synthesis work where we get to kind of make meaning from all this together. So. Try to go from one teacher section to the next teacher and just know, keeping in mind that we will have time to be able to construct meaning at the end. So I'm going to tell our friends out that are listening that you can turn off the sound for about 20 minutes. This is what we'll be doing, and I assume that you'll be doing it in your buildings as well, is teaching each other. And again, we're growing as a PLC together because we're learning alongside each other. So you can turn off your sound for about 20 minutes, and the rest of us, you can, we can just start teaching our friends at your table. And if you could have a timekeeper at your table, that would be great. 4 minutes. You may begin.
I'm so good at that.
Okay, tonight did the skills progression chart, and it talked about how we moved into third grade from more foundational skills to
It says that strong literal interpretive reading. So just looking at the learning progressions that we have word work, which I feel like we need to focus on. So students should be looking, attacking words that have multi-syllables. They should be attacking phrases that might be unfamiliar to them, figurative language phrases. So we definitely need some word work and word solving skills worked on yet to hear. And it's got the second grade progression and the third grade progression, which is so helpful. And then vocabulary building. And moving on through the progressions, fluency. And I think that fluency is not just for the kids that are reading at a faster rate. It's for everybody, because not just with fluency, with, you know, rate of reading, it's paying attention to punctuation, stopping at punctuation marks, making your voice reflect what the story says. So you're using that expression to make meaning while you're reading. And if you have a longer sentence, you know, how you combine all those parts. So fluency, punctuation, sentence complexity, that's really good. Moving through, we do have envisioning and predicting, which kind of goes hand in hand. Envisioning is making a mental picture, because kids now are transitioning into books that don't have as many pictures. And so because of that, we have to make our own mental images of what's happening in the story. So we've got making a movie in your mind, envisioning what's happening with the characters, and then predicting what, based on what you know about the character, what's going to happen next. We do have a section in here retelling summaries and summaries that you've read. And I believe inferring and then character's responses and how the characters change. I feel like all of these are familiar to us. I just don't know that we actually looked at the exact progression. I think it's so helpful. And then the author's craft, which is your analyst reading. Which, you know, I don't know that we, you know, why did the author put the exact language and phrases that he used? I'm just thinking of that book, kind of brain that we use for writing so much. Why did the author use?
I'm just excited to use these because I feel like we always tell students, well, right now in third grade we should be able to do this, but this will... Yeah, and it'll show them right now this is still our second grade level. This is, I mean, it, they can hear us say it all day long, but until they see like a concrete, yeah, it'll help them to better understand where they need to go.
The only other thing that I thought was really important to note is that in here it said that some of the skills and progressions that we hit in third grade aren't necessarily dictated by the state standard.
Oh.
But it's important to do them because researchers think that the kids should still be doing, like, monitoring to make sure they're making use of things, making sense, previewing the text, predicting what's going to happen next. Those are, they think that those are foundational skills, even though they're not currently a state standard for them, they're included in the learning progressions.
So it has state standards, but maybe just a few extra things that are still
foundational.
Right.
Okay, bend one was a whole lot shorter than what you had to read, Karen.
I didn't get it all.
Well, you did a good job. So this basically is just setting the stage for all of the units, and especially making reading a lifestyle choice. And so first it just talks about how we've got to give students... we have to give them the responsibility of this is your choice to do. And it says how the first thing you do is you're really just trying to get them engaged in these stories and telling them about their bands and having students know what level they're on so that they choose books that are appropriate. Because a big thing from what I've read is this is the time where students kind of have to look at a book and decide, can I read this or can I not read this? And not you as the teacher being like, oh, I don't know if that's on your level, but students really being able to choose that. And then it talks about how, and I know that we started this, but those reading logs and how it It's good for students to track their progress of reading so that they can see if they are reading a certain amount of volume that a third grader should read. And so I know we've always done reading logs, and then even with Lucy, we've really kind of made that more where they're timing themselves to see how long they read. But more importantly, like, you were given 20 minutes to read. How long did you read in that 20 minutes? And then it just talked about by the end of Bin 1, your students should be able to look at the same type of books and create partnerships with other students. So just really building that excitement of, I just read this book, I want someone else to read it. So that's kind of what you're setting up in Bin 1.
Reading level, but you're also assessing them to find out their reading level, like we do at the
two choices when you start the year. You can provide the students that are grouped together with individual book baggies, and those would have book choices of books on their list. Or you could let them make selections from a shared tabletop bin. So you would have a book bin on their table that they would then choose books from. So that's kind of one or two ways. And then after you have finished assessing all the students, that's when you group them according to their level with a partner that's on their level. So that's someone that they should spend, it looks like, all of unit one, and it could continue, even longer, depending on how they move up and kind of like their chemistry working together. And then, so for the first bin one, your students will be partnered with other students who are sitting near them. And then it says by session six, you'll want to pair them in the same level partnerships. Mm. That's a good thing to note.
There's your seating chart for the beginning of the year.
Exactly. And then it says it would be ideal when you do have same level partnerships for them to also be sharing the same book. So if we had duplicate copies, that would be ideal. If not, I even suggest using book swapping so they could read back and forth together. Or once they finish a book, then they swap. And then after that, they continue discussing. So they'll want to have the same books or share those books. And then it says at the end of almost every single workshop, there should be 5 minutes where those partners can discuss their books. And then we're pretty familiar. We took us a little bit to find this, but the pacing guide for Reading Lab, so that's your stone box, and it starts there. And then it shows you, we also figured out that it's very helpful to have an additional read aloud time, so it's the same thing with stone box. And then it shows just how many chapters for each lesson you should have read.
So that takes away one of those dresses.
Yep.
Yeah, we can't use it.
Three.
But we didn't buy those because we had extra copies, right?
Right.
So
yeah,
that's okay.
But we
still
need,
paired it with
we
something.
Need.
Mm-hmm.
Wait.
Well, we
no,
have to load less.
We just, we're just
yeah.
doing that.
Right. Should have a copy of those. Well, I think it kind of depends what they're working on. Like they need it in there. And I've heard before, maybe Charlene or someone saying they cut, shrunk them and cut them out and put them in their draft book.
I want to know more about that draft book.
I think it's just like a notebook.
She printed off from the online resources the anchor charts that are completed,
mm-hmm.
and she put them in like a notebook thing. And so when she has to report back to them because they're past the end, she has them, she can open up under the projector.
That's a good idea.
One more minute.
Then it's right back up for her, or she can put them on her email book.
Right.
Like, remember when you wrote the book? So she says, I can turn right to that anchor chart. You know, see, you.
There's such good information on that page, but I feel like if I don't check it all the time,
yeah,
there's
a lot.
I wish there was a way to
search
it, like, some of your grade.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Instead of,
like,
all of it. But, that's a good one. I feel like, though, what I do see is helpful.
is specific to.
Yeah.
You know how Facebook, like, if you're Googling something and then you get on Facebook, that's the ad that you get.
Yeah.
So I feel like it still kind of picks up on that, but I don't know.
I think that Facebook page is a really good resource. It saves so many of those posts to go back and get, like, implementation or
book choices,
book list, like, how, which books would be good for this. And so there's a lot of.
We're going to pull this back together and make time for a whole class conversation. So what you have been doing is you've worked together to read sections of the orientation of the unit, and you've shared with your partners, and you've tried to stay with just teaching your partners and not having that clarifying time, but it happens. And what I did see is some groups were finishing teaching, and then there was that time for clarifying with each other. I mean, over here they had a book together, and they were really looking at those progressions together. And right here we were kind of having some brainstorm about, you know, we've got some kids, and how do we get this out to them all the time, and maybe after school, and maybe, you know, at night, and just kind of, you know, just thinking outside of the box on some things. Over here, they have their foot in the water a little more than other schools, and they were kind of having some clarifying on, this section right here that explains the read aloud, this was something we had to find later on. This is nice to know that this, I wish we had known that this was here, so we didn't have to, you know, try to figure out what we were trying to read. And also there was a clarifying, we were trying to do a read aloud within the workshop time, and we really need to know that a balanced literacy approach, this is workshop, and then outside of this workshop time, there's a little bit of time every day for read aloud time. So. Third grade's a transition year, and you know this for many different ways. And in Lucy's world, yes, it is. This is when progressions get introduced, and this is when your read aloud gets introduced, a chapter book read aloud of this sort. So this is some new work. Once your kids get in this routine, this will be new work for them. And just for you to know, to be able to tell them that is half the battle is, guys, this is hard work. This is new for you. And if you don't know that, you don't know to tell them that. So we are going to participate in a whole class conversation. And this is how this works in a classroom where you provide time for kids to practice talking and providing the time and then giving them feedback on their talk. But we're going to do it in a case that we're going to be able to learn from each other across the room and alongside each other. So we will clarify and construct this unit or this orientation by having a whole class conversation. I typically, as a teacher, usually start it. I usually set my timer when I'm like building stamina for whole class conversations. 5 minutes seems to work nicely, and we work up more stamina for talking long about a topic. I'll set my timer for 5 minutes and I'll just start the conversation. And then I encourage you to jump in and add on to something I've said, or maybe you have a new understanding that you want to bring to the table with our friends. I reference this chart a lot. While there are other sentence frames out there, absolutely. But this seems to be a nice one, this one that is carried over across our units. It just kind of pushes our talk to talk longer about a topic, and it also kind of pushes it so we sound more sophisticated with our talk. So I'll just start it, and then I'm going to set my timer for 5 minutes, and I'm going to actually push us to talk long about one topic. I'll start with, I used to think that reading logs were detrimental to kids reading. I'm now starting to think about a reading log as almost a reflective piece of my own teaching. Am I giving them enough time? Like a reading log can track if I'm giving enough time to these kids to read.
On the other hand, I think that it provides
responsibility of knowing that when they're reading and the time is up, seeing how long they read and how many pages that they read mm-hmm. to decide, like, did I read enough in that time? And just to keep track of, I read for 30 minutes and I only read 10 pages. Mm-hmm. And them seeing that pattern of, am I reading more in the same amount of time?
Able to have conversations about reading at home and at school because they document at home and at school, and so it has helped me see who's reading at home and who's just reading at school, and then it brings conversations to them. And I've had several students that encourage each other now to read at home because they say, look at your reading log, you haven't read at home, you should do that.
And I'll just add on to what she has to say. The same thing, they're checking each other when they come and sit down at the carpet about what they read at home versus what they read at school. And a lot of my kids were noticing, I can read 20 pages at school, but I can only read 12 pages at home. What's going on? And so we had to have that discussion about, where are you reading? Are there distractions? What can you do? And kind of make a plan. They make a plan for themselves how to fix that. Because if they can do it in one place, they should be able to do it in another place as well.
I think it's interesting to note that on this, the way these reading units are structured, that that the read aloud is not a whole class text. We're not all going through this text like a travel agent. Like, I'm not reading and saying, look here, and look here on this page, and flip, and look here on this page. Kids, it's built in that this is a time that you get to hear me read, so I get the text. I noticed on one of the things she references, if you have a kid that has to track print and wants to do that, absolutely get them a copy. But for the most part, the message is, let's just enjoy, you know, just enjoy hearing me read like you used to be able to hear your teachers read in K-1 and 2.
To add on, our students really loved, in our last unit when we read aloud when Dixie to the class,
and we made time for that every day. And it became where it was like their very favorite part of the day. And if we couldn't read on because we hadn't done the next lesson, they would be like, what? Can you please just read the mm-hmm. next chapter? So it's been fun to see them get excited about it and ask for that time to mm-hmm. continue to see what happens in the story.
I can add on to that. just to add on to the because of Winn-Dixie, I've also seen students in my class who just absolutely love any book by Kate now, and they want to read every book that's out there by Kate, and so they just, I think it's just engaged them more to just open their minds to books that they probably would have never, you know, I don't think I probably would have ever seen anybody reading because of Winn-Dixie this year. So it's just kind of helped their engagement with what they want to read, so.
I loved how you just referenced Kate as she's your best friend. Your best friend. That's, you know, I love that culture that she could just walk in the door any minute. So she's, you know, I spend time with her all the time, and I'm learning alongside her. Love that.
So you don't have to walk back and forth?
Oh, everyone else will get it. So the other thing about Read Aloud that I think is so important is it kind of builds a community in our classroom. We've all read the same thing. All the kids can talk about the same thing. And we're making connections from Stone Fox to Winn-Dixie. And even when I'm not leading the discussion, they're discussing it. Oh, that was just like Opal. Remember when Opal did that? And so as a class, even though we may not have a lot of things in common that we all do, we're all reading different books, we all like different things, we all go different places, that's our that's kind of what brings us all together. We cry together, we sit and laugh together, and it's just, it's amazing. It's what every classroom community needs.
Absolutely. Coming from middle school, that is definitely something that's a new understanding, or not a new understanding, but just to say, yes, read aloud. And one of our tech, Starhole, read alouds, a kid had a little scuffle at recess. But our kids could say, at social, we had something similar to what Johnny had in the book. And I felt like we all just kind of, oh, yeah, we know. And it just kind of brought us together. It did. And that's a nice way to say that. Thank you. So you saw that there was a little lull in that conversation. That's okay. That's something that if you were to practice this in the classroom, what they see you is, we're not giving up on this. We are going to keep talking about this topic because it's not a one and done topic. You have something to say. I want to build on what you say. So it really instills that and lets those kids know that we're going to keep doing this. We're going to keep talking. You also saw me pull a chair. I'm wanting to be with you. This time here in the 10-minute mini lesson, I am your teacher. I'm going to stand here in most of your rooms. I'm sure they're sitting on the carpet. But I'm teacher, or I might be sitting in the chair, but I am the person who's teaching. This time, I'm with you. I'm learning alongside you, and whatever I say is just as important as what you say. And I'm also, this is a piece of feedback, in our rooms, we've kind of worked to maybe sit in a round in this way, and then that way the eyes don't always come to me, because we're talking to the group, and so that's a feedback for them, is we're all talking to each other, and the eyes are on the speaker. Whoever the speaker is, that's who the eyes should be to, and that's a lifelong skill that we should all practice. So we have successfully finished one lesson today. We completed one reader's workshop lesson. I taught you a way that you can unpack a unit of study. That can be replicated at any grade with any new unit. That structure is the same. We got to actually practice that, and then we practiced it by sharing and kind of constructing some meaning of what some of the things we were wondering about, or maybe some of the things that felt good to us. So we completed that, and so that feels good, and it's good that I tell my students and you that we did a good job. We did good, and that feels good to kids to hear, and it feels good to the teacher. Oh, we did something, and we're going to keep doing something that really well. But I am going to ask that I need to probably go to the bathroom and just kind of refresh before our next lesson. And our next lesson will be how to plan for the next week of instruction. So, and I'm sure that you probably need to check in with subs and however, whatever you need to do for about 5 minutes. And then to know that I'll teach that next lesson. And then we'll have a longer break. So I like to be able to let you know. We'll have a short 5-minute or right now. And then we'll probably do a 10 or 15 after this next lesson. Sound okay? All right. If you're out there listening to us, you can turn off your sound and then be back with us in about 5 minutes.
moment. But
instruction, and I'm hoping that you leave with some tips if you're a person who or a group that has already done a little bit of this work before. I think you'll appreciate or glean some new information about what I'm going to share with you today. Or if you're a person who has not tried this type of work at all, but you've planned with your PLCs before, I do think maybe you'll see how this process might help you as a team be more collaborative and also maybe more efficient with your time. And I'm going to invite, to start this out, I'm going to invite Young and Shaw with us on the carpet today. And just like we did before, they'll come and you'll do the same work, but you'll be able to kind of watch and see what this looks like in a pretend classroom. So your tools today will be that first unit. You're building your reading life. You'll need a writing tool, and you'll probably need some type of piece of paper, whether it's a sticky note or a pad of paper. So three tools, and you are invited to come to the carpet. So Karen, I've set the timer for 10 minutes. When it starts to get close to maybe one more minute, if you could just kind of tell me I'm getting close, that would be really helpful. I still have to do that. I have a pretty good idea of what 10 minutes feels like when I'm planning, but I still need my timer. And and the purpose for that is that I don't lose, I don't cut any time away from you actually doing this work or any type of instruction. It's not so much about what I tell you, it's about what you get to do and process about a new topic or any new learning. So today, readers, I'm going to teach you a way to plan for your next week of instruction. And here is my little story that I want to tell you. Similar to the past story I told you, we implemented reading workshop last year, and we turned, well, how it looked was I took my book home, I put it in my bag, and I took my book home and I read lesson one, and my friend put hers in her bag and she read lesson one, and everybody on our team read lesson one, and then we would go to our classrooms the next day and teach lesson one. Actually, we would shut the door and teach lesson one. And then we did the next thing, and we turned to the next, the lesson two. We put that in our bag and read that at night, and went to our classrooms and shut the door the next day and taught that lesson. By Wednesday, we were calling in for subs because we were tired and we were exhausted. And, you know, what's happening? Why is this so hard? I thought it was easy for you, and I was afraid to tell you, and I thought I was failing. And Cynthia, I mean, we know, we've talked through this. It was not sustainable to keep that up. So we needed to kind of work to make that work for us and good for our kids, because that's not good to have a sub after every few days, and then I'm grouchy when I'm back because I'm tired. So anyway, that's my story. What I'm going to teach you today is a way that you can plan for your next week of instruction that is sustainable, and I think that you will, just like on the past lesson, you kind of got an overview or arc of how the unit was going to unfold. This practice today will kind of give you an overview or an arc of what's going to kind of take place in these classrooms over the next week. So that's helpful to know too, because if I teach lesson one and I have no idea what lesson two is going to be, or by Friday what needs to have happened all this week, it's just not good. So let's just say that was not good, and we refined our practice. And then we also got some feedback from Lucy last summer, on how to even refine that more. And when Lucy gives you feedback, you take that feedback and you say, yes, ma'am. And we did it, and absolutely it kind of changed. It was kind of a game changer for us. So I'm going to share this knowledge with you with the intent that you can certainly implement this in your schools, or you can tweak it to make it work for you. So my purpose is that I want to make this sustainable and that you have more time. You're not reading the mini lesson for 5 hours. I would prefer you to spend less time planning that and planning more time for how you're going to pull small groups, because that's honestly the heart and soul of this work. The mini lesson is fantastic, and it is wonderful, and it's beautiful when it's taught great. But actually, this is where we probably need to be. John Hattie talks about know your impact, know thy impact. It's not impactful to spend a whole lot of time working on that mini lesson. This is where you're going to get your impact, okay? So this process today will help you with that. I asked my teachers if I could video them doing this, and while they were not really pleased, because, you know, it's embarrassing, or it's not embarrassing, but it's hard to share, or know that others are going to watch this. So please, again, be kind to them. They're just a PLC trying this process, and this is just 1 week of instruction or 1 week of planning within a year, and you're going to be able to get to see them do this. And I think you'll see what's happening is I'll assign the lessons to them. Yeah. I thought I had it. Guess not. Nope. Okay. I'm going to assign the lesson to them. They'll get to read that particular lesson. They'll become an expert at that one particular lesson. And they're going to read the connection and think about, make meaning of that. I call it, kind of get a gist for what's Lucy's saying in that connection. And maybe write that or highlight that piece. Then they're going to look at the teaching point. And then they're going to write the gist or highlight that part and do the same for teaching, active engagement, and link. This is where that baseline where I needed y'all to know that that most of her lessons, follow this same structure every single day. And it follows the same structure within the plans, and she expects the or likes for the instruction to follow that same plan when you do deliver the instruction. So you're going to see my friends read and make meaning, and then they're going to actually teach each other the lesson within 4 minutes. So it's kind of it's fast, and sometimes especially when we started this work, a teacher would sit in the chair and just get to the connection, and the timer went off, and you're like, that's as far as I got. But that, you know, we just knew that this process would get easier for us, and so you'll get to watch that. again, it's just you're just watching a PLC do their thing, and then knowing that you're going to actually get to do this work as a PLC when I release you, okay?
Friday's typically our day that we plan for next week of instruction, and we know that our goal is plan for next week of instruction, and the purpose for doing this all together is working together to build a shared knowledge is the best way to achieve goals and meet the new needs of our students. So we'll do the protocol that we've been practicing this year of learning how to plan for next week of instruction as a PLC and fast. So what I will do is assign one lesson to each person, each member of the PLC. You'll read that lesson for 7 minutes. You'll practice the same skills and strategies that we ask our kids to do. You'll read a chunk. I would probably assume that you're going to read the connection chunk and then jot. Read the teaching point and then jot. Then teaching, read the teaching part. Think about it, and then jot. Active engagement, you'll read, think, and jot. And then the link, think, and jot. And we, as a PLC, we're pushing ourselves to even go beyond that for this process to kind of think about the mid-workshop point and our small group instruction. So we'll read for 7 minutes, and then we'll actually come to the carpet and teach each other. So each one of you are going to become an expert of a lesson for next week. Are we ready? I'm going to set my timer and then I'm going to assign. So, Sarah, you're going to be lesson 6 for next week. Sandra, you're going to be lesson 7 for next week. Janet, you'll be lesson 8 for next week. Melissa, you'll be lesson 9 for next week. And Kim, you'll be lesson 10 for next week. And we will begin. Carpet, and we'll start with Monday's lesson, which is number 6, and that will be Sarah.
Okay, students, you have seen multiple different maps in your social studies classes. Well, today I want to talk to you about some of the some older maps. When maps were first being created, when they were first discovering the waters, they would actually place a dragon on the maps where there were trouble spots. So if there were maybe lots of sea creatures there, or if there were hurricanes in that area, or if it was just a part of the water that they hadn't really explored yet, they would put dragons all over this map. And I have a picture for you here to show you. Well, we're actually gonna do that, look for those areas of trouble in our fantasy stories. So today, I'm gonna teach you that in your fantasy stories, your characters often face different kinds of dragons. Some of them are literal, we have dragons in our fantasy stories, but some of them are metaphorical dragons, and they symbolize those problems, those trouble areas that your characters are gonna face.
I know that there's something I can learn from Harvey. And what I think about Harvey is that he's a boy that started off self-centered, and he made a lot of mistakes, but he's trying to undo those into trying to be brave. So what I'm learning is that you can make mistakes, but still pick yourself up to do better. As I'm about to send you off, I want you to choose some life lessons that you're learning from your book. Now, I want you to narrow it to just one, and you're going to need to be ready to explain it to somebody else. So I want you to quickly jot just one idea.
Okay, welcome back, readers. Today I'd like to talk to you about our mini lesson, which is on our fantasy unit, and it's talking about internal quests, knowing that quests can be internal as well as external.
So you have all studied history in different ways. You've studied World War II through Number of the Stars. You've studied the Civil Rights Movement through Ruby Bridges and Martin Luther King Jr. You know about historical characters just like you know about the fantasy characters in the books we're reading now. The fantasy characters in the books we're reading now are magical. They're not real. They don't exist in real life, but we learn the same lessons from them as we learn from historical characters.
Readers, I want you to think about a famous athlete that you know and somebody that's really good at something. And I want you to think about, do you think they just make a lot of money with what they're doing and they just stop doing it? Or do you think they try hard to keep getting better and better and better? That's what we need to do as readers. So today I want to teach you that you shouldn't just wait for somebody else to look at your reading and to help you figure out how to make it better. You should be doing that yourself. You need to constantly ask it, what can I do to be better at this skill? So I want you to watch me as I look at my last night's writing about theme, and I want to compare it to the progression today. And I want you to watch as I kind of go through this to really honestly look at myself to figure out what I need to do better. Oh gosh, ooh, I need to do better on this. I didn't even do this part. Okay, so I think I'm going to be a 4. Okay, so now I need to figure out what my next step is. Okay. Yeah, I know exactly what I need to do next, okay? So what I want you to do right now is I want you to pull out the writing that you did last night on your theme. I want you to open it up, and I want you to use the progression that you have in your notebook, and I want you to figure out where you are with this writing.
Are there any tools that need to be prepared before your lessons? Any of the resources?
The day of my lesson, there are a list of themes that will need to be printed off, you'll need to have a link to there's a historical figures with their dragons and their lessons that they learned that you'll need to be able to project on the meeting.
Do you think we need a copy per student of the themes, or could we show that up there, or will we need that at the tables?
You would need a copy of the themes for each student, but for the one with the historical characters, you would just need one to project.
Okay. All right. Readers and writers, we have...
plan for your next week of instruction. So if you have 5 people at your table, that's fantastic. If not, you can just be responsive and make it work. But we're going to have 7 minutes to read a particular lesson. It might be lesson 1, 2. Let's just start with lesson 1 at your table and go to at least 5 at least. And then each member will teach the assigned lesson for about 4 minutes. And we're going to work to actually teach this. So when you read, you're going to maybe read not just for understanding, but how am I going to actually teach this lesson? And picture yourself sitting in that chair as a teacher. This is peeling off the skin of some of us and just building that we're transparent with each other, and this is not easy work. So this is just a feedback from Lucy was that we were telling each other about the lesson, and Lucy just said, I really think you could probably get more bang for your buck by teaching. And I'll kind of, after we finish, we'll kind of talk about the difference between telling and teaching each other. So without any more ado, I think I'm going to say those fancy words and get ourselves into this unit and getting us ready to plan for our next week of instruction. So off you go. If you're listening in, you could probably turn down your sound for about 7 minutes and do this same work at your buildings. Okay.
Thank you.
more minutes. All right, so that was pretty fast-paced work, and you'll hear me say frequently that her phrasing and the way she says things repeat themselves across units and across grade levels. So your reading will get faster because similar things will be said along the way. I saw several of you, if you're a highlighter, if you're a person who highlights and thinks of just after you highlight, that's a certain strategy, obviously, a fantastic strategy. Another strategy that I've seen is people using post-it notes, and that works as well. It's whatever seems to work best for you. But what you did see on the video is something that that we didn't steal from Shaw, but borrowed from Shaw. They had, I guess, Cynthia, you had sent me a picture of a teacher with a pad of paper like this, and it just kind of highlighted the connection and teaching point and teach and active engagement and link in mid-workshop maybe. And I think it was for a totally different purpose, or maybe it was for the same purpose. But what we did as a PLC, we pushed ourselves because we were highlighting every word. And really, as nonfiction writers, we shouldn't read with a pen in hand. We should actually sit on that pen and read and think and then jot. So that was where we were in this process. We pushed ourselves, said we get one sticky note, right? What you get on that one sticky note. And I mean, we've tried to push it to write on the back and add another sticky note, but that's where we are. We're just trying to like get this thing manageable. So that's where we are in the process. But if you're a person right now that's highlighting or needing to type it out, you know, that's where you are, and that works fine. But that's where we are in this process, and we learn something from you and make it work for us. And it's been kind of a fun game. Literacy people, we say we're kind of fun suckers, but that's kind of fun. That was a fun game for us. We try to stay on a sticky note. So we are going to try this work. I don't know that you necessarily need to have a chair in front of your table to have a teacher, but I will say within your PLCs, I strongly encourage you to have some type of model that there's a, and now it's Tuesday, and someone comes and sits and teaches, and then now it's Wednesday, and someone comes and teaches, because otherwise, we have these clarifying moments in between our teach times. And then we don't get to clarify as a group. We run out of time. So let's try. I'm going to release us to have some time to teach each other. 4 minutes. Each person will get to teach the lesson and do it as best as they can. But with teacher talk instead of telling each other. I'm just asking you to try that. But And we will, if you're out listening to us, we're probably going to turn the sound down for about 20 minutes. And hopefully you'll practice this work just like we're practicing this work here in this building. And you may begin.
Last year I read the new Yeah.
All right, writers and readers, I'm gonna set up a routine of snapping two times, and that'll call us our attention. And writers and readers, if you could have eyes up here, I've made an instructional decision to stop now, and know that this wouldn't happen during a PLC. It would be very to the T that every person gets a time and gets the fair amount of time to share for the week. But for purposes of what we're doing right now, I'm going to stop us, and we're going to practice that whole class conversation again. And this, we are now clarifying and constructing a coherent overview. And so some of the things that might sound, it might sound like this. I noticed you were talking about the Just Right books. Should my kids be matched in Just Right books by the end of the week? I mean, we're just kind of having those kind of conversations. You might have heard me on the video talk about those logistics, like what copies do we need, what do we need, but more importantly, like here's the scope and sequence of the week. Where, you know, how does this lesson build on this lesson, and this lesson build on this lesson? And I'd like for us to, we've just learned with our table, but the whole class conversation allows us to learn from each other. And I'm going to set my timer for 5 minutes again, and we're just going to push ourselves to talk long about what the process or the protocol that we just did. And I'll go ahead and start my timer, and know that I usually always have this one around for me. And we'll just start it right here with one of the things that why I have so enjoyed having us teach each other is we don't get enough time in each other's rooms, in each other's classrooms. And what we've done in our PLC, we kind of get a glimpse of how you teach and how you hold a book, or if you lean forward and talk to the kids, or if you lean back, and just seeing those behaviors of how you deliver instruction. We're actually learning from doing that, and we don't even know that we're learning along the way, and that's been really neat to see. And just in here, just I've seen the personalities come out when you're saying curmudgeon. In these faces, you're making these faces, and I'm not teaching the lesson, but I'm kind of thinking, okay, that's the kind of face I need to make. You know, I'm going to work on how I'm going to do that in my room. So I was very pleased with how y'all have the morning group wanted to really go back to telling each other, but I think curmudgeon, that lesson kind of lends itself to kind of having some fun with it, and I applaud y'all for being so just open and trying new things, because this is different type of work of teaching our friends. So I just talked really long, and out of that 5 minutes, I'm sorry. Does anyone want to build on what I've said? Sorry. Thank you.
As a team, we have been in the practice of each of us taking a lesson and doing how you spoke about it to begin with. And I think at first we're all like, oh, that's a little uncomfortable. I don't see the value in that. But as we did it, I saw something that was beneficial was there's less talk about understanding, clarifying questions that needs to happen, mm-hmm. I think. But it helps people get through their lessons in case one of them talks too much.
So oh, does that happen?
It's happened in our PLCs before. I think for our team, that could be helpful for us to do it in that kind of setting and presenting it in that way, because it could be more focused, and then maybe have a time for those clarifying questions.
I think another reason why it's important to do this in PLCs, we at Shaw actually have not been doing this kind of work in our PLCs, but we all said today that we have to start just to kind of take that load off of ourselves. But I think we also still agreed that, yes, it's going to be very helpful to assign a session, but I think it's also really important that you still read the lessons, mm-hmm. And maybe not as in-depth as the lesson that you're going to be teaching your
colleagues, but I don't, I just want people to understand that it's still something that you're going to have to look at. But it definitely helps because we'll catch each other at lunch or, hey, if somebody had done the lesson, you know, and somebody hasn't, hey, can you kind of quickly tell me what are the things that you hit? And just even like a 2-minute conversation really helps to know, okay, I need to make sure I say that, or I don't need to say that and move on to this. But I just think we talked as a group that it's really important to still read the lessons, but that this is definitely going to be very beneficial in planning our instruction.
What you said earlier about the reading workshop model, how the mini lesson is not the focus, mm-hmm. it's the conferring and that time that they were spent, that's why I enjoyed this so much, because it took the stress off. Like, I feel like I know now if I wanted to teach lesson one, just the overview, like I don't have to focus mm-hmm. as much on it because Amanda did a great job teaching that. So I really can. And I will admit that the mini lesson has been my big focus because mm-hmm. I don't want to miss anything. And the most important chunk has taken the back seat because I don't have time mm-hmm. to do it all. And so just having these little tidbits of like, okay, this is an overview of what that is, I think that's definitely very beneficial.
And I just wanted to, I agree with everything that's being said here. I want to add on just that, for myself, I feel like I need to speak naturally about the topic, so I kind of have to put it into my words. Mm-hmm. And I like Lucy's words, but sometimes it's not exactly, you know, as natural to say those things. And so I want to put it in the language that my kids would understand in our rapport. So to get that natural feeling, you really do need to make it your own, but getting the gist of the lesson from your colleagues is invaluable. Don't miss that step.
Karen, I probably have told y'all when I've come to Shaw, but if you drive from where I live and to Sonora, it's not unusual. I'm just letting be honest here. It's not unusual for Charlene to be driving and practicing the lesson while I'm driving. I pretend like I'm on the phone if somebody's right there, but I have to do that in my own words. And it just takes that. Like, I can read it all day long, but I need to have some practice. That's where I am as a learner. I have to practice that, so I'm practicing while I'm driving. Yes?
And I think it's really good, though, to go over what her words are, because like you said, some of these words repeat themselves across units. And so I think we have to, it's a fine line between making the lesson our own and making sure that we're staying true to the way that Lucy teaches it, because it will come back, and if they don't have it, then you're going to have to, oh, what did I say? What did I do? Mm-hmm. It's there. For me, I try to make the connection really my own. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I have to use hers if I'm like, I'm not really sure. But like the teaching point, I say word for word. Yeah. You know, some of the things where I'm sending them off and I'm reminding them to do this during the link, that I just word for word. And sometimes I just say, boys and girls, Queen Lucy said this so well, yes. I'm just gonna read right what she said. Yeah, she's Queen Lucy. And the kids are like, oh, that's fine, I don't care. I mean, like, it's okay to read word for word if you're like, wow, that is powerfully said and you need to hear it just like that.
I really agree. This morning we had a group sitting right here and they had said the lesson one said some pretty deep words and the teacher was like, I'm gonna say them, but I don't know if I really should say them. But by lesson five, person that was sitting over here was like, you needed to say that, because by now they needed to already have heard that. So, you know, just having that scope and sequence just for the week kind of tells you, yes, do that lesson, do that teach or whatever, because you're gonna need that by Friday. And that's been helpful, like just to know by week or by bend or by unit, but just to, so we're not just teaching one lesson and say, oh, well, I don't know what tomorrow's going to be. You kind of have a gist of tomorrow. And I have a mental image of the gist of tomorrow from what I saw you do. And I have a mental image, of the next lesson because what I saw you, teach me in PLC. So, again, this process, our timer went off a long time ago. We did talk long about a topic. So, not only did y'all teach each other, y'all are like GT in here. Y'all did teach each other, and we had no problem talking long about a topic. So you have just completed another lesson, and this is a way to plan for next week of instruction. Two things. So it's sustainable. So we don't have, I have to call for a sub tomorrow because I fell asleep with my Lucy book. And then second is, so it's sustainable and, that we are actually to have time to do this type of work and really think purposefully about how we're going to group kids or what we're going to say to kids with that small group instruction. So it is not so much about what I say, but it's much about what I do. And if our kids are getting to do this work, then that's where the actual learning is. So you should feel success that you have completed this, and maybe you have something more to add to your tool belt. Maybe you could think of a PLC, how to make this work in your PLC, or I welcome feedback on how it's working in your building, because we're learners too alongside you and other schools. We are going to take I promised a longer break, but actually we're going to take a 7-minute break. Does that sound all right? A little seven, and then we're going to kind of switch gears. And so you've participated in two lessons, and then we're going to switch gears into a panel discussion, and Meredith will lead that for you. So I'm going to set my timer for 7 minutes and just take a break or keep talking Lucy with your friends. Okay.
Yeah.
Welcome everybody back. We are moving into the next section of our training today. And we have a panel of Shaw and Sonora teachers, and they have been working with the units of study for several months. So this is your opportunity to ask them questions. They will be giving tips, advice, maybe things they wish they had known before they started the units. So hopefully their advice will help you as you get ready to roll these units out in May. So those of you who are here in the room, you're more than welcome to ask questions, and I'll bring the mic over to you. And those of you who are out at your schools, you are more than welcome to send Megan your questions through the YouTube channel. So do you want to start off with any tips or advice or things you wish you had known before you started? Okay, I'm just going to give you all the mic and you all can pass it, okay?
So the first thing that popped into my head was how important it is to have a leveled, accessible library for your kiddos to shop from.
I just got this today from the reading, but one of the things that it talks about in the first unit is that you don't want to so much focus on how much writing they're doing about reading in the first unit. And I feel like that's a big push. Like, we want them writing about what they're reading. We want to see what they can write. And Lucy said that if you build up their, how much they're reading, if you build up their discussion about their reading, that will support their writing, but it'll come a little bit later.
I think I can speak for most of my team here that you need to plan ahead with what you need. We just did a book study unit, and about the sixth lesson through, it was like, make sure you have your books pulled with the sequence book. And we were like, oh, we were supposed to pull two books when we are pulling our book club books. So just really looking ahead at the very beginning of the unit to know what all materials you need, because you might not need them till session 8, but we had no idea that when we were pulling our books that we should have been pulling a sequence book that goes with those books. So looking at that and looking at all the online resources, that those are, we learned, are very, very helpful. Is there anything else?
I'll add to that what she said, but reading the overview is very important at the beginning of the unit. It just lays out when you need things and what you need and if you need books that go together. And also for your read aloud book that you're using, it gives a detailed list of how many chapters you need to read before each lesson. And all of that is very helpful to find before the unit instead of mid when you're several lessons in.
I think one of the best things that I can say is maybe work on one component of your reading workshop time at a time. Don't try to put it all together at once. I mean, you're going to put it all together at once, but get, you know, master the 10-minute mini lesson first. Then look at how you can get your small group and conferring underway. Take it little chunks at a time. You don't have to be the expert at everything all the time. It's a little overwhelming. Something else is plan a pre-assessment before you begin your units. So if you're going to start session one of unit one on, say, Monday, the week prior to that, you need to be sure that you've done the suggested pre-assessment that is all, and the resources are there. You can print them online and decide how you want to administer that and how much time you're going to give to your students to do that. And look at their work.
They're not easy, and they look different than, and I'm just chiming in with the pre-assessment. They look different. The vocabulary, the verbiage, they are not easy. And so you may, just the way that it's set up, so you may have kids just thinking that they failed and they don't know how to do it, and just encourage them, guess what? You're going to know how to do this by the end of this bend or of this unit. Yeah.
Can I get that? Adding on to that, also, you'll want to have a day where they self-assess themselves, and they'll start using the student rubrics to assess themselves. And it's really hard work at first, and it's really hard on them, but you'll refer back to a lesson that you did on grit, and you'll say that over and go, this is hard work, but it's worth it. Use your grit. And I think that's been really helpful. And the pre-assessments and post-assessments, they are challenging for them. But we saw that as we went on in other units, they weren't as hard. And that just gave us confirmation that what we're doing is making a difference, and it's helping them.
And this kind of goes with several people's, but using those online resources, one of the things our team found was a video where the teacher was using the learning progression, and she had enlarged it so this she didn't have to look at the little bitty things that they had in their binders, or she didn't even have to have it, but it was big, so she could teach a small group and pull from it. And then that was so useful just in the lessons. You could just point to the learning progression. So if they weren't quite at a level 3, you could say, this is what you need to do to get there. And so the kids had all the tools and all the resources that they need to get to where they're supposed to do. So it's helpful to have those online resources, but then the kids can set goals and try to meet those goals without our constant support, just our coaching to help them along.
And do self-assessment throughout while you're conferring. Where would this sticky be? Would it be on a level 2 or a level 3?
And can I just say, I'm going to. Can I just say, put that Lucy book in your lap when you're teaching those lessons, and literally, if you need to, just read from it. And the kids, they really don't care. At first, I was like, oh, this is gonna be awful. They're gonna know I'm not the expert. They really don't care, and the lesson goes just as great, and I feel like I'm really teaching to fidelity what it is that I'm supposed to teach. So don't be afraid, just put that book right there. I keep mine on the table, but it's okay.
I was going to say, we kind of jumped all the way around these assessments and everything. You do have a book called Learning Progressions, and performance assessments, and it tells you all the stuff we're talking about. So if you have any questions about that, you do have a book for that.
Karen, oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say that one of the things, and Cynthia and I have talked about this, I think it's really important, is to read that overview all the way through, the green book, we affectionately call it, because even though you're going to read the units and you're going to read the overview of the units before you go into them, it is really good just to have that overall view, and it takes you through where all the resources are online as well as in the green book and what pages they are. But it just sets up, and to hear sometimes just her verbiage, I know it just lit a fire under so many of us about I'm going to teach these kids to love reading and be readers. And so I would just encourage everybody, summer as you're lounging, I'm sorry, I'm a nerd. It was just a really good read. Really, really good read. And it just, it lit that fire under me again about teaching kids to read.
Karen, can you talk about the Worthy books?
Lucy has suggested book lists, I believe, for each or many of the units. I'm not sure I found them for everything, but books that, you know, are levelized for with the Fountas and Pinnell levels, you know, L-M-N-O-P. Something that we struggled with was the kids, you would teach your mini lesson and everything was great, and the books that she has you, that you teach with, are just perfect for the lesson. And then the students go off to do the work, and the books that they've chosen for their book baskets or for their work for that day may not be exactly some of the Worthy books that we need to get the skill out of them that we want. For example, you know, for the character studies unit, we needed books that had really great characters that were overcoming obstacles, that had some that, you know, their actions were shaped by their experiences. And if they're reading something that doesn't lend well to that, you know, but it's an interesting book for them, you're thinking, okay, so we're interested in Pokemon, and I want to read all about the Pokemon characters, but really that's not worthy for the lesson that we're working on. So in my class, we kind of coined the phrase, you know, get your Worthy book, and they know, and we compared it to Winn-Dixie. So if they were, you know, we were talking about because of Winn-Dixie, which is so worthy, we would say it's got to be a Winn-Dixie kind of Worthy book, where that character is, you love that character and you just can't wait to read more about that character. And so that helped. And so when they were making their stacks of books on their desk, using the Worthy book phrase, I guess that's, you wanted to talk about that. That's not a Lucy thing. I think that's just what we said. That's really good. Yeah. Because you want them to have the books that they're interested in, but they also know, ooh, Winn-Dixie, Opal, that was a Worthy character. So.
Good. Can you all talk about your students moving through the levels and how they're moving through those levels and how you know when it's time for them to move to, say, a new band of levels?
Well, Lucy has provided some quick assessments. I know at Shaw we do the BASS assessments, which take a whole lot longer, but the Lucy assessments are great because they just read a passage for a minute and then they answer four questions about the passage that they read. And so that helped us decide quickly if they were moving up levels. So we could do that during the conferring time. If we felt like we were listening to a child and we had noticed a big difference in their reading, we would just pull out our binder with those quick assessments and do that 1 minute quick assessment. And
I'm sorry, your quick assessments, where are those from? Can you talk a little bit more about
they're
those?
They're from Lucy, right? They're from the Teachers College. You can access all that online.
Okay.
And so we just printed them all out and have a couple copies for each one. So that's how we were able to see very quickly if our students were moving up. And there's about 3 to 4 levels in a band. And so because those assessments were a lot quicker than pulling a whole BASS assessment, they were able to move up quicker in that. Okay.
So do any of you do in-book assessments, like just kind of on the fly, or all of you using those assessments that can be found online, or? most of you all are using the online assessments. Mm-hmm.
So I'll just say that I haven't been using those. I'm like, oh, that's great. So the way that I think we've been doing it is just using our running records. And that happens during that conferring time. When I meet with a kid one-on-one or individually, I can have them open up their book, which should be a book that's just right or on level. And so I can just have them read to me for however long, a minute or until I get a good feel. And then I can just ask them a few questions if I feel like they've got it. I usually want to see them be able to do that a couple times. I know Miss Sandy is great at, she is, don't let that look fool you. She's great at like keeping up and keeping a tally. And if they can, if they've proven to her or shown that they can do that within multiple texts, then she'll move them up. But I think this would be much more efficient and effective. And we already have the resource, so.
Okay.
Wait until it's an assessment time to see if they have moved a new level, because it's all about books on their level for the work that they need to do. So if it's too easy for them now, that's no longer doing them any good. So there's those quick assessments and just running records, but then of course the assessments that come every couple times a year. But yeah, I think we've learned, you know, to try to, If we notice that kids are moving, to go ahead and assess them and move them instead of just waiting for an assessment period.
So this is just piggybacking off of that. Of course, we don't wait for that assessment window when we see that a kiddo's ready, but I was seeing that several of my kiddos were ready, about eight, and so I was doing the assessment, moving them up, and then the other 17 were like, well, are you going to test me? So they want like their new levels, and they want their new bands, and they want their new ranges, and more so than I've ever seen before.
Can I stop right there? And I don't know if everybody out in the schools can heard what you just asked, but the question was asked about the Caden books. Do they have to be purchased or are they online? So, Regina, do you want to answer that?
Yes, the Caden books do have to be purchased, and so we didn't want to add another thing because we implemented in January. But I did purchase the Caden books. And that's why I got that. So we've purchased the Caden books, and they're up to level, I want to say L or M. And then after that, it's paper copies that you can print off for higher levels, that it's just phrases, so there's not a cost for it, and they are on the website. So the only cost is your copies and or purchasing the Caden books at the lower levels.
Mm-hmm. Yes, just to reiterate what you said, those can be purchased off the Teachers College website, and they have the prices, and they have an order form and everything.
So. This kind of has to do with assessment, but sometimes hearing all of these things gets overwhelming. But Lucy does such a great job in all of her lessons of teaching you about it and telling you in lessons, and she even brings the running records and says, this is a great day to do some running records. So sometimes hearing all these things might be overwhelming as you start this, but Lucy just remembers it all and puts it all in that lesson. So if you're reading your lessons, these things will all be taught to you very explicitly.
Okay, we've been asked a question through the streaming site. Are the units specific in telling when to start book clubs during independent reading? Yes.
Okay. Yes, they are. Okay. Okay. If you read the orientation to the lessons, they will tell you which bend you're going to start in and give you some idea. So it's really, that orientation is really important to know which books, what type of books to pull and when to pull them.
Well, and we also found out that second grade kind of starts some book club things at the end of the year. So we were relieved at that.
So we'll just take the mystery out of it. So book clubs start in the third unit. And Lucy, very scriptedly, is that a word, sets them up for you. I mean, like, she tells you how you're going to help the group set goals and what procedures they're going to have and how to set them up and how to help them talk to each other. It's all there. But it doesn't start until Unit 3, which we were talking today. We thought, why not before now? They weren't ready to talk on this high of a level lesson, Unit 1, Unit 2. They needed all of that to get to this point to be able to actually talk.
And one thing we found was very helpful is there is a list of great books that you can pair together, or just books that are all about bossy characters or characters that love animals so that they can find connections with the books. And that's also online.
So that's part of the... That's part of what we were talking about earlier about the overview, how you really need to look at that and see ahead what you're going to need, because some clubs are going to finish before others and get ready to move into their second book. And if you don't have their books ready because you didn't know they needed enough, you know, then... Right. And then they weren't really waiting on us. We did have a second book ready, but it didn't really correlate with, you know, that was definitely a mistake that we made and that we'll learn from. But I have a quick little positive story about the book clubs that I wanted to just kind of throw in there about just how we've seen such a change in the kids. But I have a little boy in my room who just has never been a big reader. He's not interested. He doesn't care. He's into sports. His mom's a former teacher, and it just breaks her heart because she has every book in the world at home for him. And he told her that his favorite thing that we were doing at school were the book clubs. And so for him and for her, that was huge, because she didn't think that would be something that would come out of his mouth. So yeah, the book clubs are really, really great. And then they move into what we're in, research clubs. So that helps set the stage for how they need to be in a club again. But look through that overview of what you might need and those online resources of different books to choose for the kids to help with.
We've had another question come in. How do you fit in guided reading groups and small group work?
I do not want to start that. I will chime in, but.
It's been one of our biggest concerns, is fitting in that guided reading. And it's not doing away with guided reading, for sure. You'll spend that conferring time. You'll pull different types of groups, and one will be a strategy group, which will be based on the work that you've done in your mini lesson and work that they've done in the past. Another type of group you can pull is the guided reading group as well. I feel like what you said earlier about being a master, don't have to be a master all of it, that's where our team's ready to strengthen our skills at, and probably become our PGP for next year, is getting better at how we can maximize that time in the planning and carrying through. But you're not getting rid of guided reading, but I've seen students, I had a student who was stuck on a level and did guided reading faithfully with her every single day, and then we go to Lucy, and I was worried about her because she wasn't getting that. And this past, when I assessed her last time, she moved four levels. So it confirmed, once again, that the work we're doing is working. Lucy works for us, what we said.
Trust the system, that's right.
It's hard to quote Charlene when she's in the room, and I might quote it wrong, so we might need to take the mic over there. But when Charlene was talking about this conferring time with us, I think she said, like, 1-1-1, is that? Like, if you can, in the beginning, just do one conferring group, like where you're looking at what they're actually doing during your lessons, pull them and work on a strategy with them, one guided reading group, and one individual conference where you do a running record and you talk with them, she said that would be a great start. So that's kind of how I was like, okay, if she says it, I can do it. And so that's kind of how I've tried to set up that time, is just that 1-1-1, one strategy group based on what they're doing, one guided reading group where I'm still talking about the strategy with them because they need it, and one individual conference, sometimes two if I can fit in two individual conferences. Was that right, Charlene? Oh, I got a thumbs up. That's good.
Thank you. Are there any other questions from our visiting teachers before we wrap up our panel? Any other comments? Thank you all for sharing your knowledge. We really appreciate it. Thank you. I think it'll help everybody get started with their units that they're going to be teaching in May. So thank you very much. We'll take about a minute or two to transition into the next portion of the training. Thank you guys very much.
We've put together a little getting started guide, kind of nuts and bolts to get you started or things you might need or want to know about. I'm going to go really fast to get you out of here. And this, you'll be able to access this through the Google Classroom. The first thing we're going to look at is the implementation timeline. It's April now. We're in PD. In May, you'll start teaching the units. We're starting with Unit 1. Charlene, where can they find those sample? We know, like, a lot of the lessons start this year, boys and girls, we're going to blah, blah, blah. So we did a couple samples of how you could change the verbiage for the end of the year. For example, Next year in fourth grade, you guys are ready to be fourth graders, and this is how fourth graders are going to need to read. Kind of change that verbiage a little.
And that was really helpful. And I, whoops, let me show you. They have worked to annotate the first unit, the first lesson in unit one, and they've annotated it with, you know, just like, this isn't the first day of school. This is you're great readers, and this is what we're about ready to start. So within your Google slide, they have annotated the first lesson for you.
Just giving you some suggestions of how you could change that. Back to the implementation guide. Then this summer, we're going to have 3 days of PD on June 19, 20, and 21st. This is voluntary. We're calling it structured planning time. You can come for all 3 days. You can come for 1 day. You can come with your entire team. You can come by yourself. It's completely flexible. You don't have to sign up. Just come here. And what we're going to do is we're going to review and discuss questions or concerns you have after you've done this initial pilot. You're gonna spend most of the day planning your first fall unit, and TOSAs will be available to support you and your team as you go through this process. So we won't be up here teaching a lesson, but we'll be working with you as you plan. And then Charlene is going to have little mini workshops, and you can attend them if you want or not. You can continue planning, you can take a break and go do a little mini workshop, 20 minutes maybe at the most, and then come back to your planning. So we really want to make it useful for you. And if your principal chooses, you can get flex time for that. So that will happen on June 19th, 20, and 21st from 8 o'clock to 3 p.m. So we'll hope to see you there. In August, you will have additional PD during that week we come back to school. You'll have a day of PD The content is yet to be determined. We'll be going to study with Teachers College this summer. The TOSAs will be going. So what we learn there, we'll bring back. It'll probably, and what we hear from you will kind of determine what that content will be. In the 2017-2018 school year, the expectation is that you will deliver 45 minutes per day of reading workshop per the units, per the Teachers College units. That you'll follow our district curriculum calendar, and I'll share that with you in a minute. There will be continued PD on scheduled district PD days. So we've committed to making sure you get enough professional development with in this process. Your TOSAs will be available for you however you want us to be available. We can come and co-teach with you. We can do coaching cycles. We can come to your PLC, your faculty meeting. We can come before school, after school. You can call us on the phone if you just want to cry and vent. Or, you know, there's no dumb question. You can email us anytime with questions. We are here for you and to support you. Let's talk about that curriculum calendar. Megan, if you could scroll down to third grade. We've kind of given a timeline for how the units should go. This first year of implementation, we want to teach Unit 1, Unit 2, Unit 3, Unit 4, and we have a timeline for that. And then at the end of the year, if you feel like you need things from the if-then curriculum, then you can use this if-then curriculum. But for this first year, we really just want you to focus on those first four units. There is an expectation that you'll do BAS or DRA at the beginning of the year and at the end of the year, running records along the way, and the pre and post assessment for each unit. And I have those linked in here for you. You can also get them at the Heinemann site. We are not implementing the Teachers College writing units this year. So we'll continue to use our Springdale writing units as a resource. We have taken the writing out of the units and linked them here separately. Now, a little change we made to third grade, based on the feedback I heard from you, we separated information writing into two units. So the first time they do information writing, they will be writing chapter books about an area that they are an expert in. And we're stealing that from Lucy. I mean, we're ripping her off. It's in our Springdale format. And then they won't do that research writing until the last unit. So we separated those out a little bit so they can get to be good information writers before they're starting to do that other critical skill of researching. So you'll find those linked in here. We have padded the units, especially the first one. We know it's going to take a while to teach those structures and routines. That's so important for this process. So while Lucy will say a unit takes between 4 to 6 weeks, we've tried to be really generous with the time we've given you because we know it's going to take longer. Whenever you learn something new, it's going to take longer. And then we've also tried to provide about, I think it was 5 weeks, Megan, can you scroll down a little bit to the testing? 5 weeks for an entire unit on testing as a genre so we can get prepared for ACT. And I'll be putting some more things in here about testing, some resources, maybe some lesson plans as I learn more. Probably after we go and study with Lucy this summer, we'll have more information about that and try to give you some more support. But there is support in this alignment info here, and I'm sure this is a familiar document to all of you, where we have taken the ACT Aspire skills, the standards, the Springdale curriculum units, and now we've added the Calkins units of study. So as you're preparing for ACT Aspire testing, you can see, okay, my kids really need more work in main idea before testing. Where can I find support in the Springdale units? Where can I find support in the Lucy units to help you? Okay. structures and routines. I took chapter 6 from your reading workshop book and I just condensed it into this one page. It's almost like a checklist. What do you need to have in place before you start a mini lesson? You need to have assigned partners or triads. You need to have assigned spots at the meeting area, transition signals. What do I need to have for independent reading? I just tried to take that chapter and condense it and almost make a checklist for you. I still think you need to read that chapter, but this will be a quick check to get you ready. Architecture of a workshop. Okay, this is a planning tool that you could use for lesson planning. And I just went through and looked at each part and put some statements under here what to think about as you plan that. In independent reading, what the teacher's doing, what the students are doing. So you can make a copy of this and use it as you want. We have it going this direction if you like it that way, and then I made another one that goes this way if you like it better. So whatever you want to use, and you don't have to use it, it's just a sample. I know a lot of teachers have asked questions about what about lesson planning, what should my lesson plans look like. This may be something to help you. We've created a correlation chart, and let me tell you, the correlation chart is never going to be perfect. Okay, it is what it is. Even Fountas and Pinnell will say, you can't correlate. But we've tried to do that anyways. Until we transition to our whole district using the BAS and our libraries get those F&P labels on their books, this will work. And because we're saying students can read in a band, it's okay if the correlation isn't perfect because they're reading in a band. And while we're talking about this, let's not be crazy about their book level. If they're passionate about reading a book that's below or above their level, let them have that book. As long as most of the books are in their book baggie are in their level, that's okay. But I am very uncomfortable with telling a kid, no, you can't read a book because it's not your level. If you have a kid that's constantly choosing easier books and they need to be challenged, that's a different conversation. But I don't want us to be saying, you cannot read that book because you are a level M and that is a level S. You know, let's just not be crazy about that. Let's use our good teacher hearts with this. We put in a student book shopping guide. I made for your kids. I made it half sheets, so if you wanted to copy this and cut it in half for kids to keep in their reader's notebook. Magic book baggie numbers, how many books the kids will need for depending on what level they are. Characteristics of text band levels. Eventually, in 2 or 3 years, you're going to know this very well, but give yourself time to learn this, but you should be working towards knowing what is an A book, what is a CD, what are the characteristics of these kinds of books as you push kids through the levels. But do not think you have to memorize this all right now. This is your cheat sheet for right now. Benchmark criteria for independent reading levels. This is from the BAS, and this is what we're going to use as a district. Meredith started a chart in her office, all the different places where we saw a student is reading independently when they read with 94 accuracy, with 96% accuracy, 90. I mean, it's all over the place. So we're going to stick to this. And just like we don't want to be crazy with book levels, if you have a kid who's reading at a 94% accuracy in a level C and you think they're ready to move up even though it says 95, let them move up. This is a guideline. Okay, big question. We get this question a lot. Are we still doing guided reading? Chapter 8 of your reading workshop book is a must read for understanding small group instruction. And the short answer is, yes, you may choose to do guided reading. but you may choose not to. Maybe you have, maybe something is better for your kid. So if you think a kid needs that heavy scaffolding of guided reading, go for it. But if you think that that's not what they need, they just need a quick strategy lesson and they're on their way, then do that. There's a great quote from Richard Allington here, and he pretty much says, the whole point of guided reading was to be responsive to kids and their individual needs. So why would we do the same strategy every day with every kid? The key word here is responsive. What do your kids need? So you, guided reading is a tool. You may use it, you may not, depending on the kid. Okay, troubleshooting guide. If you see this red flag situation, you're seeing these kind of behaviors, these are some things you can do. And then those are the alignment docs we already talked about earlier. So that's your getting started guide, Fast Furious. It's there for you. If you have questions, email us. We are here to help you. We want to help you, okay?
That's really helpful, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. And I think we're done. Let me pass this off. Oh, yeah. We want you to do the survey before you leave. Those of you out in TV land, before you go back to your classrooms, if you could get this survey done, you'll have to be in your Google Classroom and get to this slide.
All right, so one of the things on this panel, there was a lot of verbiage going on, performance-based reading assessments and progressions and a reading pathways book. Please know that that implementation will, I am cognizant of how implementation will go throughout this. Please know that summer PD, I will definitely be looking at your feedback from this form and also from a form that will come in the future after you've taught these units, because I will need to plan for any small groups that might want to meet together this summer. I predict that some will want to come together and kind of look at the progressions and kind of look at the performance-based reading assessments. The message that's being sent out is that you will give a performance-based reading assessment to your kids in May. You will give a reading assessment, the performance-based reading assessment, and it won't be perfect. And just know that we're just asking you to just try to give it, and then know that complete, explicit professional development will be given on how to give performance-based reading assessments. And here's the biggie. It's not about how you give it. It's about what you do with the information. So that PD has to be in place, and that's an absolute non-negotiable, and knowing that that's coming. And please know that those are a lot of words that were going around, and they're fantastic things that are a part of this work. Assessment undergirds this work. And so there are many different entry points to assess our kids. And what you heard earlier are things that maybe you're familiar with or maybe will be new. And please know that we understand that. I'm going to leave with, when we talk about closing the achievement gap, the reading achievement gap, we're going to work to close the reading achievement gap by reading. It seems really logical, but we are going to work to do this together by reading. And so I leave that with that we're readers and we're instilling that we're going to instill our love for reading to these kids that deserve to know that reading is wonderful. And we're going to provide that time for them to be able to do that work. Okay. So I'm going to pass it to Dr. Morley. Okay.
I just
want
to thank you for all your hard work today. Every time I looked up, everybody's head was down. Y'all were working. And I know that's what was happening. I love it when Miss Odell said, out in TV land. So out there in TV land, thank you also to all of you. I do want to leave you with a quote. It is becoming my favorite Lucy quote. So here's what Lucy says. The research on reading achievement is unequivocal and longstanding, and it shows clearly that reading is everything. Children's reading engagement, including the amount and variety of what they read, is directly linked not just to reading achievement, but also to overall achievement. And that goes along just perfectly with what Charlene was just saying. It is, I love this, reading is everything. So with that said, thank you once again. I appreciate you. Appreciate all of you out in TV land. You have a great afternoon.